Good evening. A warm welcome to all of you to the webinar series hosted by Advocates Association Bengaluru. We have with us today Mr. Vikram Hoyilgol, Advocate High Court of Karnataka. Sir, we are happy to have you with us today. Welcome to the webinar. Now, I take immense pleasure in introducing our today's speaker. So, Vikram Hoyilgol is an alumni of ILS Pune, from where he completed his law degree. He obtained his master's degree from Harvard Law School, Cambridge, United States of America. His expertise lies in the constitutional law and taxation law, and he regularly appears before the High Court of Karnataka and other high courts and tax tribunals. He has also conducted workshops and in-house training programs on indirect taxes for various companies, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and Karnataka State Chartered Accountants Association. He has authored several articles on taxation and other issues published in leading tax journals. He had served as a clerk to the Honorable Mark L. Ulf, United States Federal Judge, Boston, United States of America, for a period of 1 year. Currently, he is serving as the Additional Government Advocate, High Court of Karnataka, and Senior Standing Counsel of Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, Government of India. Mr. Vikram is an avid wildlife photographer and a member of Indian team that won the runners-up trophy in the World Cup of Nature Photography. Mr. Vikram, on behalf of Advocates Association Bangalore, I extend a warm welcome to you. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Trivikram, for a overly kind introduction. Before I start with the subject for today, I'd like to thank the Advocates Association for having me, but more importantly, congratulate the Advocates Association of Bangalore, particularly the President, Mr. A.P. Rangnath, and his entire team, including Mr. Trivikram, for having conducted an excellent series of these webinars. At a time like this, when obviously work is curtailed due to unprecedented circumstances, the only thing I guess we could have done is to utilize this time off, because once normal times start again, we won't have time to dedicate towards learning. But this series of lectures is so important, because it's important to hone your skills during this time. So during the downtime when we can't really attend the courts, we can't spend as much time in office as we would like to. This is an excellent series, and I'm sure it'll hold everyone in good stead once normal times return, hopefully soon. Now, coming to the topic, when Trivikram first called me, he said, what would you like to speak on? I was the one who suggested this topic. And after some time, I have to be honest, suddenly I realized that this is such a vast topic, such an interesting topic, that 1 hour would be doing a bit of disservice to the topic itself, because one can go on talking about this, and if one has to go really in depth into the functioning of the GST acts, it'll take a lot longer than 1 hour. But what I endeavor to do over the next 1 hour before the Q&A is give a background to what the taxing scheme was prior to introduction of GST. How the federal structure worked vis-a-vis taxation under the constitution prior to GST. Why exactly GST was needed? Obviously, there was a need for a uniform indirect tax law. And so I'll explain very briefly why exactly we needed it, and how our, ironically, how our federal structure itself posed a significant hurdle to the introduction of GST. So I'll also explain how we overcame that the constitutional hurdle, and again very briefly give an overview of how the GST regime now works, of course keeping in mind the background, the fact that this topic which I'm talking about today is with regard to the federal structure under the constitution. So I will refrain from going too in depth into the GST law, probably keep that aside for another day. So without any further ado, I'll just, what I intend to do first, as I said, was give a background to what the federal structure was, how the taxation system worked prior to GST. And now everyone knows that the concept of taxation, particularly in a federal structure, is not easy to implement. In fact, I found an excellent quote from Alladi Krishnaswamy Iyer just 6 days into independence. This is from the Constituent Assembly debates on 21st of August 1947, where I'll quote. He says, there is no gainsaying that the subject of federal finance and the distribution of the taxing power is a difficult and complicated problem in any federal scheme of government and has to be approached with caution and discerning. And at every stage, when we are dealing with this subject, we have to remember that, after all, it is an individual or corporation that is taxed, though there may be two taxing agencies, and that there is no unlimited scope for taxation. Under the scheme of federal or financial distribution in the Government of India Act, and to some extent as envisaged in the present report, as far as possible, the object is kept in view to prevent a double levy on the citizen from two different sources. That is why certain specific taxes have been assigned to the center and certain other taxes to the provinces. So this was just, as I said, this was just 6 days into independence. This is an extract from the Constituent Assembly debates on 21st of August, 1947. Two things that struck me when I read this. One is that there was an awareness of the fact that implementing a taxation scheme in a federal structure that was envisaged then, of course, the constitution was not enforced then, was never going to be easy, simply because the financial independence of the states always had to be protected. While, of course, we had a union government, while at least a union government was envisaged at the center, at the same time, the financial independence of the states, there could be no compromise on that whatsoever. So that was point number one. And while ensuring that, the second concern, which is of equal importance, was to ensure that the subject of taxation, that is, whether it's an individual, or whether it's a corporation, whether it's a partnership firm, whoever the subject of taxes, he or she should not be subject to dual levies. For example, if there was an income tax being administered by the central government, the intention was to ensure that the same tax is not levied at the state level as well. Therefore, to ensure that the subject of taxation, the person is not subject to dual levy of tax. So these were the two important concerns before the enforcement of the constitution itself. And of course, after much deliberation and much discussion, the constitution, once it was enforced in 1950, broadly speaking, the taxation scheme was, as we all know, Article 246 being the very heart of the federal structure of the constitution, where the power to legislate on different subjects was divided between the center and the states. And of course, there was a concurrent list, although none of the taxation entries find mention in the concurrent list. So as far as tax is concerned, there was a clear division of powers between the union and the states. So for example, income tax, so that is tax on income, was reserved only for the union parliament. Therefore, the states, other than agricultural income tax, had no power to levy, had no power to legislate as far as income tax is concerned. Similarly, customs duty. There was no state customs. There was only a union custom, the Customs Act. Therefore, the power to levy customs duty was reserved only for the central government. Central excise, which is another very, very important levy for the union government, that is under entry 84 of the first list. Now that was once again reserved for the central government to levy central excise on the manufacture of goods. And also there was service tax, which was much later, 1994 it was introduced under the residuary entry, under entry 97. Although there was subsequently entry 92C, which was inserted, it was never notified, never brought into force. And therefore, until GST was brought into force on 1/7/2017, service tax continued to be administered pursuant to the powers under the residuary entry 97 of the central list. So these are examples of the taxation powers that were reserved only for the central government, for the union parliament to legislate on. And as I was mentioning earlier, it was important to ensure that the states had complete financial independence. In a federal structure like us, there was no question of divesting the states of complete powers to levy tax. And therefore, considerable powers were reserved for the states as well. And first and foremost, the most important power that was reserved for the states was under entry 54 of the state list. Now, under entry 54 of the state list, the states had the power to levy sales tax, that is, tax on the sale or purchase of goods. Therefore, any sale of goods, of movable goods, that was effected across the country, the states had the power to legislate insofar as that is concerned. Another important levy that was reserved for the states was entry tax, that is, the power to levy tax on the entry of goods into a local area for sale, purchase, for consumption, use, or sale therein. So that the power to levy entry tax also was reserved for the states. And of course, there were some other state excise, that is the power to levy excise duty on manufacture of liquor for human consumption. Entry 62, that is the power to levy luxury tax, entertainment tax. Now, these are examples of taxes which were reserved for the states. So therefore, just to give a broad overview, when under the original scheme of the Constitution, the center had the power to legislate on income tax, central excise, customs, subsequently service tax. And as far as the state levies were concerned, there was sales tax, which subsequently became value-added tax. There's no difference really. And it's just another term for sales tax, because value-added tax also was levied on the sale or purchase of goods. So there was sales tax, there was entry tax, there was luxury tax, there was entertainment tax. So there were several levies which were reserved for the states as well. Now, there's another peculiar. Now, as I was mentioning earlier, there was a clear demarcation between the power to levy tax between the center and the states. There was a third category as well, where there was power reserved for the central government to legislate on a particular levy, but the tax that is collected would be assigned to the states. And I'll give you an example of where this is. It's Article 269, where it is applicable. Now, there was, when sales tax was originally introduced in 1950, pursuant to entry 54, various states, all the states in fact, enacted sales tax laws. There was the issue of who would levy tax when goods moved from one state to another. Now, for example, if goods were sold from a dealer in Bangalore to a dealer in Mysore, there was no issue. It was moving within the state of Karnataka. There was no real issue there, because Karnataka would, at that time, of course, Mysore state had the power to levy sales tax. But if the goods moved from Bangalore to, let's say, Delhi, and the goods would move through, say, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, and then probably via Rajasthan and reach Delhi. The question was, who had the power to levy sales tax then? So therefore, there was a serious issue, because number of states started clamoring for levying sales tax. Now, the origin state, when the example I gave, Karnataka would say the goods moved from here, we want to levy tax. Delhi would say the goods reached here eventually, we want to levy tax. Madhya Pradesh would say some goods were loaded onto the goods vehicle in Madhya Pradesh, we want to levy tax. So there was a serious clamor. Therefore, there was a case that went all the way to the Honorable Supreme Court. This is in the case of Bengal Immunity versus State of Bihar, reported in AIR 1955, Supreme Court 661. It's a seven-judge bench of the Honorable Supreme Court, where the power of the Bihar legislature to levy tax on interstate sales was is questioned. It was a very lengthy judgment. I won't go into the other aspects of it. But suffice to say for the moment that the Honorable Supreme Court nudge the Union Parliament, and I use the word nudge because that's precisely what they did. They suggested that there is a strong need for a centralized law which governs these interstate sales. Therefore, in 1956, the Sixth Constitution Amendment Act was brought into force, whereby entry 92 capital A was inserted into the central list, which empowered the central government, the Union Parliament, to legislate and levy tax on interstate movement of goods. So therefore, this was an example where the central government was levying a sales tax. But under Article 269, the proceeds that were collected under the Central Sales Tax Act, which was enacted pursuant to Entry 92A, was to be assigned to the state in accordance with the principles laid down by Parliament. So therefore, the Central Sales Tax Act itself stated that, fine, we will resolve this issue once and for all. Let's stop this clamor between the states. The state from which the goods originate their movement will be the collecting state. Therefore, in the example I gave, if the goods originated from Bangalore, ended up in Delhi, Assam, wherever, the state of Karnataka would be the appropriate state to levy, to collect the sales tax, although it was a central levy. So therefore, we had three categories. One, under the union list, taxes under the union list. Two, taxes under the state list. And three, although it was a tax under the union list, it was a tax collected and assigned to the states. So therefore, broadly speaking, at the time, in the early days of the Constitution, this was the broad scheme of the division of taxing powers between the union and the states. And that is how the financial independence of the states was guaranteed. There is, of course, one more very important article, Article 270. I'll come to that later, but Article 270 deals with the allocation of central funds as well. Because as I mentioned, there are several union levies. There's income tax, there's central excise and customs and so on. Even those levies are not entirely appropriated to the central government, but there is a scheme of devolution of the funds to the states. And that is governed by Article 270, but I'll deal with that later because I just want to place some statistics and it'll flow a little subsequently when we talk about how GST has changed this quite considerably. So given this background, the indirect tax scheme, so we leave out income tax for now because that's a direct tax. The indirect tax scheme continued to function in the manner that I just explained up to 2017. But well prior to 2017 itself, there was clearly a need for a a unified single indirect tax. And again, very briefly, I just give an example of why there was a need. Now, as I was mentioning, there were various indirect tax levies. There was customs duty, there was central excise, there was sales tax, there was entry tax. Let's take the example of a car manufacturer. I'm manufacturing cars, say, in the city of Bangalore. I need some parts for the manufacture of the car to be imported from Europe. So when I import those parts, I pay customs duty. When I bring the parts into the local area of Bangalore, I pay entry tax. Similarly, I'll be buying even within the country. I'll be buying parts and accessories, say tires or rubber, steel, iron and steel from within the country as well. So I'll be paying sales tax on that because the person I am purchasing the goods from will be collecting sales tax from me. When I once again bring those goods into the local area, I'll once again be paying entry tax. Then finally, when I manufacture the car, say I'm manufacturing some parts and accessories myself also, on that I'll be paying central excise. And then finally, when I manufacture the car, I'll be paying central excise again because central excise duty was leviable on the manufacture of goods. And then finally, when I sell the car, there was once again sales tax and VAT, VAT leviable. So as you can see from this example I just gave, there were several independent levies applicable to a single activity. I just gave an example of a manufacturer of a car and you saw the number of indirect tax levies that were attracted to this, just that one activity. Of course, I also forgot to mention, let's say I hired the services of a designer to design the design the product. He would collect service tax from me as well. So there you go, there's another indirect tax. So all these levies finally found their place in the cost of the goods. So finally, when I sell the car, obviously no prudent businessman is going to pay all these taxes out of his own pocket. He's going to imbibe all these duties and taxes and levies into the price of the goods. And finally, who suffers? The purchaser of the car. So the end consumer is the one who eventually has to bear the brunt of all these taxes, all these duties. And therefore, you might have read several times in the newspapers and in news journals about what is called the cascading effect. The example I gave was a classic case of a cascading effect that was caused due to multiple indirect tax levies. So therefore, there was, right from the early 2000s itself, there was a serious movement towards having a uniform indirect tax levy for the entire country. But there was a serious difficulty and a very, very serious hurdle posed by our own constitution, posed by our own federal structure. As I mentioned earlier, indirect tax levies were distributed between the union and the states. So to have a single uniform indirect tax, there would have to be a serious amendment to Schedule 7 of the Constitution, whereby the union list would have to be amended, the state list would have to be amended. There would have to be a separate power that was conferred on the union and or the states to levy this unified indirect tax. So there was a very, very a serious problem and a very pressing problem, which could not have been easily overcome, simply because amendment to the 7th schedule finds mention under Article 368, Clause 2. Therefore, not only was there, did it have to be passed by Parliament, it required ratification of half the state legislatures. So therefore, it required a very serious concerted effort across the country, not just by the Union Parliament, but by across the state legislatures as well, whereby there would have to be some amendments to the 7th schedule, amendments to the Constitution itself. And in order to usher in this new GST regime, this new single indirect tax regime. So that went on for quite some time, right from the first decade up to 2010. Then subsequently also there were considerable deliberations as to how this can be brought about, considering the fact that there was no consensus among the states. There was, to be honest, hardly much consensus even at the central level. So it required a lot of work in one direction, and that is where the concept of cooperative economic federalism comes in. I'll repeat that phrase again: cooperative economic federalism. So in short, what it means is that the center and the states had to come together and cooperate. And even if it means that there is a relaxation or there is some ceding or surrendering of the taxing powers, they would have to come together in order to bring about this drastic change, this monumental change in the entire scheme of indirect tax across the country. So therefore, in the spirit of cooperative economic federalism, after much deliberation, after much discussion, finally, there was the 101st Constitution Amendment Act that was passed, which was brought into force on the 16th of September 2016. In fact, it'd also be relevant to mention that prior to the passing of the 101st Constitution Amendment Act, there was a failed attempt earlier to pass a Constitution Amendment Bill, which could not go through for various reasons. And finally, the Constitution Amendment Act was passed in 2016 and brought into force with effect from 16th of September 2016. Mind you, at that time, there was no GST law. So please don't mistake me when I say 16th of September 2016 was only the date on which the 101st Constitution Amendment Act was brought into force. Now, the 101st Constitution Amendment Act paved the way for the introduction of GST. And now I will explain how exactly that happened. I mentioned the concept of cooperative economic federalism, and I also mentioned how it required a significant ceding or surrendering of powers by both the union as well as the states. Therefore, in order to bring about this GST, both the union and the states gave up significant amount of their taxing powers that was previously conferred on it by the Constitution originally. I'll give you examples of that. Entry 84, as I mentioned earlier, conferred power on the Union Parliament to levy central excise duty. The entry has virtually been obliterated. And the entry now reads that the central government shall levy excise duty on petroleum, crude, high-speed diesel, petrol, natural gas, aviation turbine fuel, and tobacco and tobacco products. Therefore, from its the previous avatar, where the central government could levy excise duty on any goods manufactured in the country, the power was significantly curtailed, and it is now restricted to levying central excise duty on only the goods that I just mentioned. The reason why, of course, petroleum products continue to be subject to central excise duty is because, as I'll explain in a while, petroleum products are still kept outside the purview of GST, although for the moment, they've not been integrated into GST just as yet. So entry 84 was significantly curtailed. Entry 92A, as I mentioned earlier, of course, continues to remain because there is central sales tax on certain products. I'll come to that later. As far as the state lists are concerned, before coming to the state list, it's also important to note that I'm not talking about the power of the central government to levy income tax. Now, that remains untouched. The power of the central government to levy customs duty also remains untouched. So we're keeping those aside. Coming to the states, entry 52, as I mentioned earlier, conferred power on the states to levy entry tax. Entry 52 no longer exists. Entry 54 conferred power on the states to levy sales tax or VAT. Once again, there has been a severe, significant curtailment of the power conferred on the states. And now the power to levy sales tax is once again only on the petroleum products that I just mentioned. And of course, there is liquor for human consumption as well. There's also, which is also kept outside the purview of GST. So therefore, what the center did was gave up on its powers to levy central excise duty. The states gave up on their power to levy entry tax altogether. For all practical purposes, the states gave up on their power to levy sales tax, but retained. Remember, once again, in the spirit of federalism, the power to levy sales, like the state said, the revenue coming from petroleum products is a significant chunk of the amounts that fill the state coffers. So therefore, the states, during the deliberations that led to the 101st Constitution Amendment Act, the states refused to give up their power to levy sales tax on petroleum products. So therefore, sales tax, that is under entry 54, continues to be levied on petroleum products that I just mentioned. Then another entry that has been deleted altogether is entry 55 of the state list, which provides for the taxes on advertisements. So there is no more entry 55, which confers power on the states to levy taxes on advertisements. There is an issue here. I'll just pause here for a moment to mention, although in our High Court, in the Karnataka High Court, this issue has not been brought up at least yet. The Allahabad High Court recently, about maybe just before the COVID lockdown, passed a judgment which said that even the municipal corporations, similarly, there is section 134 of our Karnataka Municipal Corporations Act, which empowers the municipal corporation to levy advertisement tax. There was a similar provision in the Municipal Corporations Act in Uttar Pradesh. The Allahabad High Court held that by virtue of entry 55 being deleted, the municipal corporation also does not have the power to levy advertisement tax anymore. So therefore, section 134 in our current act is possibly subject to challenge in view of the omission of entry 55. Entry 62, which earlier empowered the states to levy taxes on entertainments, amusements, luxuries, that has virtually been deleted. And the only power that has been retained is the power to levy taxes on entertainments and amusements, but only to the extent levied and collected by a panchayat or a municipality or a regional council or a district council. Therefore, the power to levy entertainment tax is now no longer at the state level, but at the local self-government level. So this is, again, a significant curtailment of the original powers that were conferred on the states by the Constitution. So now the all important question, the states gave up on their powers, the union government gave up on some of its powers. It may be arguable that the union government probably got a good deal out of it, but that is probably outside the scope of what we're discussing today. But the all important question that comes now is, now how was GST brought into force? And this was extremely interesting because GST is neither traceable to the union list or the state list. In fact, it's not traceable to the seventh schedule at all. In fact, it's not even traceable to Article 246. This, in fact, in my opinion, other than, of course, acts passed by Parliament to amend amend the Constitution under Article 368 and probably some other smaller exceptions which are unique. The power to levy GST is the only independent power to legislate which is outside of Article 246 itself. So what the Parliament did, how the Constitution was amended, was that a separate power to legislate, a separate legislative power was introduced via Article 246 capital A, which reads, notwithstanding anything contained in Articles 246 and 254. So therefore, there is no question of anything anything in the concurrent list either. So therefore, neither Article 246, 1, 2, or 3, and even if there's to remove any ambiguity, there's no question of applicability of Article 254 either. The provision states, Parliament and subject to clause 2, the legislature of every state have power to make laws with respect to goods and services tax imposed by the union or by such state. So you see what the Constitution has now done. Article 246A is a self-contained provision. It doesn't refer you to Schedule 7. It independently confers power on both the Parliament and, subject to an important exception, which is subject to clause 2, the legislature of every state to make laws with respect to goods and services tax, so with respect to GST imposed by the union or by such state. Clause 2, as I mentioned, is an important exception. Clause 2 speaks about Parliament has exclusive power to make laws with respect to GST where the supply of goods or services takes place in the course of interstate trade. As I was mentioning earlier, there was a serious problem because each state decided under the sales tax regime, each state decided to tax interstate movement of goods. So here again, in order to obviate that problem from reoccurring, the Constitution says that the Parliament has exclusive power to make laws with respect to GST when the goods or services move from one state to another, where they're in the course of interstate trade or commerce. The unique part about this independent taxing power under Article 246A is that both the Parliament and the Union Parliament and the state legislatures have equal power. And I'm talking about intrastate. We'll come to interstate in a bit. As far as intrastate sale of goods and supply of services are concerned, or supply of goods and services are concerned, the Parliament and the states are on an equal keel. They can both legislate as far as GST is concerned. State, of course, is circumscribed by the jurisdiction of the state itself. So obviously, Karnataka cannot legislate GST for another state. But it is an independent and equal power that is conferred by Article 246A. And the unique part about this is that pursuant to the power conferred under Article 246A, Clause 1, the Central Goods and Services Tax Act has been legislated by the Union Parliament, and each of the states have legislated their individual state GST law. So therefore, Karnataka will have a GST law, Tamil Nadu will have, Andhra Pradesh will have, so on. So each state will have its own state GST law pursuant to the power conferred under Article 246A, Clause 1. Importantly, and this again is unprecedented, if you were to see the wording of the Central GST Act and the state GST laws, and I'm using this phrase with full confidence, all the state GST laws and the central GST law read identical, with of course minor changes. The center will be replaced by Karnataka or some small changes like that. But in order to make this GST law work, the laws passed under Article 246A, Clause 1, read identical. They are pari materia with each other. They read absolutely identical. Therefore, for any intrastate supply of goods or services, so let us say goods are sold from Bangalore from a dealer in Bangalore to a dealer in Mysore, or some services are rendered by a dealer in Bangalore to a dealer in Dharwad, what would be leviable is 50% central GST, 50% Karnataka GST. The acts read identical. The levy is absolutely equal. 50% will go to the central coffers, 50% will come to the state coffers. So you see how, for as regards intrastate supplies are concerned, how the entire federal structure was changed, and now we have a common keel, where almost a common law, although there are two laws, there's a central GST Act and a state GST Act, but the tax that is being paid is equal under both enactments. Therefore, when we say the GST on a particular product is 12%, what it in effect it means is that under the central GST Act, 6% is payable. Under the state GST Act, another 6% is payable. As far as interstate supplies of goods and services are concerned, it would be 12%, and the entire 12% would be payable to the central government. But subject to another condition, that 50% of that, as per the constitution itself, 50% of the amount that is collected by the central government under the Integrated Goods and Services Tax Act, that is the IGST Act, 50% would, contrary to, as I said earlier, under the Central Sales Tax Act, the money would go to the originating state. Now it goes, 50% of the tax collected on interstate sales and supplies will go to the state where the place of supply occurs. Therefore, if goods move from, say, Bangalore to Patna, earlier under the Central Sales Tax Act, Karnataka would collect the entire amount of central sales tax. Now what will happen is 50% of the tax, that let's assume the rate of tax is 12%, 6% will go to the central government, 6% will go to the state where the place of supply occurs. Therefore, the state of Bihar, being the state where the place of supply occurs, would be the competent state to collect that the amount. So therefore, this is the complete sea change in the way indirect tax is being administered. The earlier federal structure has been almost completely demolished and been reconstructed on the basis of the 101st Constitution Amendment Act. Now, coming back, of course, I moved a little ahead to CGST, IGST, and the State Goods and Services Tax Act. The definition of Goods and Services Tax Act has been incorporated by the 101st Constitution Amendment Act itself to mean any tax on supply of goods or services. So therefore, it's very, very broad in scope. Any tax on supply of goods or services, except taxes on the supply of alcoholic liquor for human consumption. Therefore, there is no GST applicable on the supply of alcoholic liquor for human consumption. There was, of course, an issue with regard to whether the raw material, that is, say, extra neutral alcohol or rectified spirit, which is used in the manufacture of alcoholic liquor for human consumption, whether that is liable for GST or not. I remember some years ago, we had given an opinion to the central government, had called for an opinion, and given an opinion saying that the raw materials would not constitute supply of alcoholic liquor for human consumption, and therefore the state would have the power to levy GST on that. But my the latest understanding is that the central government has taken a slightly different view. So therefore, even the raw materials that are used for the manufacture of liquor, they are also outside the purview of GST. of course, to give that opinion, we relied on several judgments, including in the case of Bihar Distillery versus Union of India. That was, of course, much prior to GST. It was reported in 1997, volume 2, SCC 727, where the Supreme Court had relied on the user test. Therefore, if extra neutral alcohol was being removed from a factory for industrial purpose, it would fall completely outside the scope of the state's purview. If it was being taken out for manufacture of liquor, it would fall within the scope of entry 51 of the state list, and therefore excise duty would be levyable. In that case, the Supreme Court applied the user test and said, at the time of removal, the authorities would have to see for what purpose it is being removed. If it is being used for industrial purposes, the states would not have any power over that. But if it is being removed for manufacture of liquor, then the states would be vested with the power. But that issue, in fact, I thought had reached finality. But just today, I was informed that there is still a significant gray area. The concept of IGST, which I was mentioning earlier, where 50% of the integrated goods and services tax is assigned to the state where the place of supply occurs, that finds the principle is enshrined in Article 269 capital A, which was once again freshly inserted by the Constitution, by the 101st Constitution Amendment Act. And it says that goods and services tax on supplies in the course of interstate trade or commerce shall be levied and collected by the government of India, and such tax shall be apportioned between the union and the states in the manner provided by Parliament. Therefore, the Constitution itself said that integrated goods and services tax, which is leviable on interstate supplies, shall be collected by the government of India, but it shall be apportioned in the manner prescribed by Parliament. And where is this prescribed? In the Integrated GST Act itself, under Section 17, the section very clearly states that half of the IGST amount, as I was mentioning earlier, half of the IGST amount shall be apportioned to the central government and the balance to the state where the supply takes place. So again, you see, the earlier federal structure has seen a complete sea change. The federal structure vis-a-vis taxation, where there was a clear demarcation between the power of the union and the states. We are now in a position where there is a uniform taxing power that is under Article 246A. There's a central GST Act, there's an integrated GST Act, and each of the states have GST Act. So therefore, the one nation, one tax may be strictly speaking a bit of a misnomer, but we get what they mean. One nation, one tax would mean that there is one GST, although it would be integrated GST, say Karnataka GST, Andhra GST, and so on. But the concept is that all taxes would find the taxes, indirect taxes, being levied on the supply of goods and services would be pursuant to the powers conferred under Article 246A. So therefore, you see, the earlier federal structure has now completely done, has seen a sea change. It's not even recognizable now, the way it was and the way it is now. The other serious, some would say, compromise on the federal structure is the creation of the Goods and Services Tax Council. Now, this is a new constitutional body which has been created under Article 279 capital A of the Constitution. It is chaired by the Union Finance Minister, and the members shall be the Union Ministers of State across the state. So they'll be the Union Minister of State in charge of revenue and the ministers in charge of finance and taxations in each of the states. So it's a very, very high-powered body, and its powers are extremely wide-ranging. Under Article 279A itself, it states that the powers of the GST Council shall include making recommendations on the taxes and levies that are to be subsumed in the GST. And when they say subsumed, as I was mentioning, central excise duty has been subsumed into GST, sales tax has been subsumed into GST, entry tax, and so on, to the goods and services that are to be exempted, the model GST laws, the threshold limit of turnovers, the rates of tax, and special provisions with regard to certain states, and there's a residuary power, there's any other matter relating to GST. So therefore, the GST Council is a high-powered committee which has significant powers to make recommendations which will which can seriously alter the very face of GST itself. And this is where, when I said some would argue that there is a compromise on the earlier federal the powers of the state, according to 279A clause 9, the vote of the central government has the weightage of 1/3 of the total votes cast. So therefore 33% of the power is vested in the central government, and the remaining 66% is distributed among all the states. Now there is significant material written on this, that this is a serious compromise on the state's power, because although it seems quite innocuous that only 1/3 is for the union parliament, for the central government, the states have significantly ceded powers when they say that the states have only 66%. Now all the states combined have 66%, as opposed to earlier where they had complete freedom, complete independence vis-a-vis the states that were reserved for them under the state list. Interestingly, Article 379A clause has been inserted under Article 368 clause 2. So therefore, now to amend any of the powers of the GST Council, it would once again have to go through the entire process of getting ratification by half of the state legislatures. So this is Article 379A has been placed on a very, very high pedestal as regards amendment of the Constitution. So therefore, to amend Article 379A and to either divest it of any powers or to curtail any of its powers would take a significant constitutional amendment once again. Now, again, in the spirit of cooperative economic federalism, there was another very important demand by the states, which is that they were concerned, the states were concerned that we are moving from an earlier regime where a fixed amount of revenue, not a fixed amount, but a significant amount of revenue was being collected by the state governments. For example, sales tax was a significant revenue. The state said we're giving up on that power. Entry tax, of course, was a slightly smaller levy, but there was still a fairly large amount that was being collected by the states. The states, as I said earlier, said, sorry, we are not giving up on our powers to levy sales tax on petroleum products, because that's a significant amount of money that is coming into the state coffers. But at the same time, now we are giving up on several other powers. The states asked for compensation for a certain period. In other words, the states were worried that the introduction of GST would lead to a significant reduction in the collection of revenue, and therefore they requested the central government, and the central government inserted it in the 101st Constitution Amendment Act itself under section 18 of the 101st Constitution Amendment Act. The central government said that the parliament shall by law, on the recommendation of the GST Council again, provide for compensation to the states for loss of revenue arising on account of implementation of GST for a period of 5 years. Therefore, from 2017, when GST was brought into force, 1/7/2017, for a period of 5 years, by Constitutional Amendment Act itself, the central government assured the states that the states would be compensated for any loss they would incur on account of introduction of GST. In order to give effect to this compensation, the Union Parliament legislated the GST Compensation to States Act. Therefore, I come back when I say one nation, one tax, now I'm adding one more tax. So there is a GST Compensation to States Act, where under there is a cess that is contemplated on certain specified quote unquote sin goods. That's what the government calls it, sin goods. And these sin goods are aerated beverages, tobacco products, coal, high-end luxury cars. So therefore, on these products, there are varying rates of cess that is payable in addition to the normal GST payable. For example, there is a 12% cess payable on luxury cars, cars that are above a certain length. So therefore, this 12% cess would be payable in addition to the normal GST payable of 28%. That is 14% CGST, 14% SGST, plus another 12% cess. So therefore, 40% is levied as tax on these so-called sin goods. But when I say 40%, that's only for cars. There is, I think, for tobacco products, the measure of tax is entirely different. So, but suffice to say that there is an additional cess payable under this act. And why was this cess being collected? In order to compensate the states for the loss of revenue on account of introduction of GST. Therefore, the idea was this cess shall be collected and that cess shall be utilized to compensate the states for the loss of GST, thereby satisfying their own obligations under Section 18 of the 101st Constitution Amendment Act. How is this compensation to be calculated is another very, very interesting aspect. The Section 4 of the GST Compensation to States Act states that for the purpose of calculating the amount of compensation, the financial year ending 31st March 2016 shall be taken as the base year. So therefore, the assessment, the financial year 2015-16, whatever revenues that were collected, which have, when I say revenues, those taxes that are collected by the states which have been subsequently subsumed into GST, let us say it is 10,000 crores, that 10,000 crores shall form the base. Then Section 5 says that, Section 6 would say that the cess shall be levied in order to compensate the states for the loss. And under Section 3, the projected nominal growth shall be 14% per annum. Therefore, year on year, assuming that the states grow at 14% per annum, the shortfall of revenue collection, would be compensated to each of the states by the central government. Now, just to give you an example, I've culled out the statistics for the state of Karnataka. This makes for very interesting reading. The base year, as I said, is 2015-16. So the protected revenue is 36,144 crores. Therefore, that amount forms the base. As per Section 3, we are assuming a 14% growth rate every year. Therefore, 2016-17, of course, GST was not there for 2016-17, so we'll skip that year. For 2017-18, so there was 14% for 2016-17, another 14% for 2017-18. That amount works out to 46,973 crores. 2018-19 is 53,549 crores, and so on. So how does this work? Now, let's take the example of 2018-19. The protected revenue, that is the base amount collected for 2015-16 plus 14% year-on-year growth, the protected revenue is 53,549 crores. So it is assumed that if not for the introduction of GST, the state of Karnataka would have collected 53,549 crores. In reality, the GST collection was 35,208 crores. Therefore, there was a significant shortfall of 18,340 crores in collection for the year 2018-19 as compared to the 14%. Of course, this is an assumption. When in 2015-16, the growth rate in the country in general was far higher. So maybe the 14% growth rate in hindsight may have been a little over-optimistic. That's my personal view. Of course, I mean, I'm not even daring to look at the COVID situation now, because you're probably looking at almost a negative growth rate. So let alone a 14% growth rate. So for the year 2020-21, one would shudder to think how exactly this compensation is going to be paid. But even in a normal year like 2019-20, and 2019-20, to be fair, was probably affected for about the last month, because by March, things started shutting down. But even then, there was a shortfall of 18,340 crores compared to what is assumed to have been collected prior to introduction of GST. So that amount has been, in fact, yesterday, coincidentally, as I was preparing for this, I saw the entire amount for all the states has been released by the central government. In fact, I have the exact figures for the whole year. The amount that was released was 1,65,302 crores for the year 2019-20 was released. And in fact, just yesterday, coincidentally, as I was saying in the press release, I found this amount. So a significant amount has been released by the central government. Interestingly, the cess collection, which was meant to offset these payments, was the cess collection for the year 2019-20 was only 95,000 crores. So therefore, there was a shortfall of 70,000 crores in collection of the cess. That amount was, according to the press release yesterday, that amount was made up by transferring certain amount from the consolidated fund and adjusting certain amounts which were collected, which had been collected as cess during the previous year. So therefore, there is a significant progress that has to be made as far as working out the economics of this is concerned, because both the center and the states have to seriously sit across the table and work this out. Now, I don't even want to shudder to think how it's going to work in a post-COVID world. I know we're running out of time. I'll just take another 5 minutes or so. As far as the GST compensation cess was concerned, the act itself, interestingly, was challenged. And it was a very interesting argument that was taken. And at first blush is would sound very, very acceptable. In fact, the Delhi High Court even granted a stay on the collection of the cess when the act was immediately challenged. And the act was challenged essentially on the ground that there is no legislative power for the Union Parliament to levy this GST this GST cess. Section 18 merely says the central government shall compensate for whatever loss. That cannot be an independent legislative source of power. So therefore, the argument was that Section 18 cannot possibly confer any legislative power. There is no Article 246A does not confer any separate legislative power. Article 246A subclause 2 does not confer any legislative power. Therefore, the act itself is stillborn. That was the argument. But the against the interim order passed by the Delhi High Court, the Union of India went to the approached the Honorable Supreme Court. And in the case of Union of India versus Mohit Mineral, reported in 2019, volume 2, SCC, page 599, the Honorable Supreme Court has upheld the validity of the act, tracing the power to the residuary entry 97, read with Article 248 of the Constitution. 248 Clause 1 states that Parliament has exclusive power to make any laws with respect to any matter not enumerated in List 2 or List 3. There is no such power under List 2 or List 3, admittedly. And Clause 2 clarifies that this power under 248.1 shall include the power of making any law imposing a tax not mentioned in either of the lists. Although one of the arguments was that this is a cess, not a tax, the Honorable Supreme Court said that no, this is it can be read as a tax, and therefore we will read it into Article 248.2, read with entry 97 of the central list. Before winding up, I'd told you earlier that I'll make a brief reference to Article 270. So the federal scheme, just to sum up, the way it works now is central GST goes to the central coffers. Therefore, for an intrastate supply, 50% goes to the central coffers, 50% to the state coffers. Integrated GST, which is for interstate, 50% goes to the central coffers, 50% to the state in which the place of supply occurs. And of course, there is the GST compensation cess, which is collected by the union government and used in order to compensate the states for the loss of revenue. The last aspect I want to cover is vis-a-vis Article 270. There is a misnomer that the entire amounts that have been collected by the central government, be it income tax, central excise as it was earlier, or even now under IGST or CGST, the entire amount goes to the states. But that would be an incorrect assumption, because under Article 270, the taxes referred to in the even the union list, and there is subsequently an amendment which says even under collected under Article 246A1 and 2, shall be levied and collected by the government of India and distributed and assigned to the states as per the percentages prescribed by the president after considering the recommendations of the Finance Commission. Therefore, the Finance Commission, which as you all know is constituted for every 5 years, would make a recommendation every year to the President. And based on those recommendations, even the amounts that are collected by the union government would be devolved to the states based on the percentages that have been recommended by the Finance Commission. And just to give an example, I went through the latest Finance Commission report, which was submitted in November 2019. Once again, I will caveat that with the fact that in November 2019, nobody in the world expected the disaster that happened in 2020 March onwards. But based on that, on the recommendation, when they are making those recommendations, the Finance Commission would give weightage to various factors. For example, 15% is for the population of the state, 15% is for the area. So therefore, higher populated states would get a larger devolution. States with a higher area would get a higher devolution. Interestingly, states with a higher forest cover, in order to incentivize greater forest cover, would get a greater devolution. Income distancing. Now, income distancing is a very complicated economic concept, but to put it very, very simply, it is the distance between the highest state GDP. Now, they've taken Haryana because there are smaller states like Sikkim and Goa, which would be slightly skewed. But taking Haryana, the distance from it, now that amount also is given a certain amount, 45% of the weightage is for that. Demographic performance, like population control and so on. And the effort in collecting tax, so 2.5% is for that. And then with a very, very complicated economic formula, which I will not go into, there is a percentage which is arrived at by the Finance Commission for the last year. 41% of the total collections, when I say total collections, they're obviously less the amounts that have been expended by the central government for collections, and they may be litigation costs and so on. 41% of the net collection is reserved for the states. And based on all those above criteria, the Finance Commission has recommended various percentages to each of the states. Now, I'll just conclude with the state of Karnataka. Interestingly, 3.64% has been allocated for the state of Karnataka. So about 3% of about 41% is allocated for the state of Karnataka. So about 100 rupees collected by the central government, about 1.5 rupees would come to the state of Karnataka. So this, as I mentioned right in the beginning, it's a very, when I chose the topic, I was kicking myself a little later because suddenly I thought that 1 hour cannot possibly do justice to this. But I hope I've been able to clearly explain, at least give a broad overview of how the federal structure has undergone a sea change thanks to GST. I think with those comments, I'll hand it back to Trivikram. For some Q&As. Thank you everyone for being very patient listeners. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vikram, for a very comprehensive presentation. Now I think can we move on to the Q&A session?
Please.
Mr. Akash, request you to unmute all the viewers and let me just check the Q&A box. Yes. Q&A box has zero questions. We can start with the first online question, please.
Hello. Good evening, Vikram. This is Yogesh Kumar.
Hi. Yes, Mr. Yogesh.
Good evening. I have a little personal question regarding our advocate.
What was the basis? I knew that question would come. Let me tell you at the outset, no advocates are liable to pay GST.
I know. What is the rationality behind it? And one more thing, it is reverse charge has been done. Why it is so? Only for advocate.
You do know that I'm a government advocate and my my views
are... No, it is a curiosity. We know the answer. So.
Yeah, exactly. No, but then, yes, exactly. So there was obviously a clamor for that at the central level. Even service tax. Now, the service tax also, advocates were always kept outside the purview. So as of now, the structure is very clear. If advocates are providing services to individuals, completely exempt, we're providing it to a corporation or a body of individuals, it's on reverse charge. So
thanks to the author who is also belongs to our...
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you. Can we have the next question, please? Can we have the next question?
Hi, Trivikram. Kamalacharan here.
Yes,
Vikram. Fantastic overview of the entire situation. I think I may have missed it. Can you come back with the percentages of distribution of collection of tax vis-a-vis the state GST, central GST, and the IGST, please?
Okay, so how it works is, we will divide into two supplies. One is an intrastate supply, one is an interstate supply. For an intrastate supply, 50% would be central goods and services tax. So let's assume some goods are being sold at say 100 rupees. On that 100 rupees, let's say that those goods attract 12% rate of tax for mathematical simplicity. We don't take an odd number. So on that 100 rupees, 6 rupees would go to the central government under the CGST Act. 6 rupees would go to Karnataka government. If it is an interstate sale, all 12 rupees would go to the central government, but 6 rupees out of that would go to the state in which the place of supply occurs. So therefore, as I've given the example, if goods are being sold from Bangalore to Patna or Madras, the place of supplier, there are very, very complicated rules, let me tell you, which gives rise to tremendous scope for litigation. As regards the place of supply under the Integrated Goods and Services Tax Act, there are at least about 6 or 7 provisions, one for goods, one for certain category of services, another for another category of services. There are several sections, highly convoluted sections. Applying those sections, you will have to arrive at where the place of supply occurs. And 50% of that integrated tax that is collected by the central government will go to that state. So that's how. So it's 50-50. Across the board, it's 50-50. Cess will go entire 100% to the union. No. The devolution will come only subsequently based on that, the loss, the protected revenue and the losses based on that.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Vikram. Can we have the next question, please? It's a very complicated subject. So we have very few questions. Or yes, sir, please go ahead.
Sir, myself, Manoj Kumar, I'm a faculty at Keli Law College, Bangalore.
Sir, you're not audible. If you could be a little more, if you could raise your voice, it could be convenient for us. Sir, you can go ahead with your question. My only request is kindly be a little more audible.
Sir, can you hear me now?
Yeah, sure. Please carry on.
Sir, this GST amendment as well as enactment as such definitely has changed the federal relations. But there has been allegation that it has affected the federal structure as such. Mm-hmm. What is your precise opinion as to whether it has affected or whether it has improved the relation between center and states?
Now, if you're asking me whether it has adversely affected, I don't.
Yes.
Maybe it is early days. It has definitely affected. As yes. I was mentioning, it's almost unrecognizable from the federal structure of taxation that existed prior to the 101st Constitution Amendment Act. So, as I was mentioning, Article 246A is extremely unique. It's something that we have never seen before. So, if you ask me, has it affected? Definitely. Has it adversely affected? I would reserve my comment for maybe a few more years. It's still very, very early days. And also coinciding with GST, we have seen a general slowdown in economic growth. And then, of course, COVID. Now, this is going to skew all the economic statistics when we're going ahead to study what is the impact of GST. But yes, to answer your question, in short, it has affected, yes. I would like to believe it has improved it. There are obviously early teething problems, which we are seeing right now. But to get an overall picture, we might have to wait a few more years, particularly in light of the general slowdown in economic growth and the COVID disaster.
Okay. Sir, I have one more doubt. Kindly correct me if my understanding is wrong. Earlier, there used to be a different sales tax in different states. So hence, there used to be, if he is purchasing a particular goods in Karnataka and he will become same tax in every state, tax rates in every state, a kind of a equality has been brought in. So can't we consider it as a good point on the...
No, certainly. The intention behind the introduction of GST, the uniformity that it has brought is certainly a good thing. If I can be slightly critical of the GST Act, it is the procedures prescribed are slightly complicated, a little over-reliant on technology, but the overarching intention and scheme of the Act cannot be found fault with. We desperately needed a unified indirect tax scheme across the... I gave you that example of a car manufacturer. Not only are all those taxes being imbibed in the final price, please think of the dealer, how many compliances he has to file returns under customs. He has to file, of course, customs continues. He had to file returns under entry tax, sales tax, rental excise. I mean, now it's just one return for every month. Of course, chartered accountants would correct me because there are actually three returns a month, one for outward supply, one for inward supply, which is why I said if I have to really find a fault, law could have been simplified to the extent that procedurally it should have been a little more simple. But I definitely cannot find fault with the intention nor the scheme.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Joe Joseph has a question. Yes, please unmute Mr. Joseph.
Yeah, good evening, Vikram. Sir, it was... Am I audible?
Yeah, please.
Yes, Mr. Shivaraj.
Quite informative for me. In fact, it's the first of the kind that I have heard about GST like this. Thank you very much on behalf of everybody. I have got one question. When we raise an invoice as advocate services, straight. Now, when we bill, we give bills in split form. Which of the heads, if you can just let us know that they are protected, not taxable under GST, or because nowadays we offer...
elaborate. Yeah, please.
We offer a little comprehensive kind of a legal assistance to clients, not just appearances in the court, and it might be even copying, xeroxing, certified copy application, all those things, and also even certain licensing works, visitations and all, where the people, you know, in criminal practice, there are certain other ways, extension, and in spot visit, all these things are there. I really want to understand from you, which are my legal services to which GST is exempt?
I can just keep it very simple. These are all semantics. You keep a simple, unified, you want to charge X amount, keep it under one head towards legal professional charges. That's the end of the story. No, you don't need to break it up. You want to, a chartered accountant would probably advise you even better how you can break it up. But in the invoice, my suggestion would be keep it a simple, professional charges towards legal services. There will be no questions asked. In fact, I thought I should mention that, but for lack of time, I couldn't. I get a lot of queries about notices issued to advocates under the old service tax regime. Let me clarify this. And I'm saying this with full responsibility that the government accepts that there was a slight error in issuing these notices. And why? I can tell you this with full responsibility simply because I've spoken to the authorities. What had happened was, under service tax, there was no question of levying service tax on advocates. But when they integrated the systems of income tax and service tax was leviable on anyone with a turnover of over 10 lakhs. So when that system was integrated, almost automatically, they just saw anybody with a 10 lakh plus turnover would be issued a service tax notice without actually checking what services they're providing. So that was clearly an error. So which is why I think to answer your question very simply, keep it as simple as possible. Expenses, of course, would be in addition. So there's no question of charging GST only on those expenses. So keep it simple, legal and professional charges plus expenses. I don't think there should be a problem. But once again, I'll request a chartered accountant to probably advise you even better.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Joseph, sir, you have been unmuted. You can go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Evening to both the Vikram sirs and other participants. Really enjoyed it. Systematically, it was explained. So now, there was a multiple point tax collection in the earlier stage. Now it's been unified and it is given a normal common thing all over India. In this, the buyer of a car or a product, is he any way benefited because of this, sir?
Let me answer in two parts.
Please, sir.
It's a very good question because in fact, in the beginning, if you recollect, I said I will not go into the details of the GST law simply because of lack of time.
Okay.
But one very important aspect of GST I did not touch upon at all is the aspect of input tax credit. Input tax credit is what, let's assume A sells to B. A sells a car to B. A collects 100 rupees as tax. No, not the, let's say the sale value is X amount and collects 100 rupees as tax.
Right.
If B is a consumer and he is not providing any further services or he is not selling any goods using that vehicle, then there is no question of credit. He will have to bear the entire amount of the burden of tax. But let's assume this purchaser is a transporter. He is providing the service of goods transport. The tax amount that has been collected, because this is nothing but an input for him for the providing of subsequent output service. So when he supplies the service, he's using the input which he has purchased, which is namely the vehicle. The tax collected from him can be utilized as tax, as credit. Therefore, if his output is say 150 and the tax collected from him is 100, while calculating his net tax liability, he will reduce 100 rupees from his total liability of 150 rupees and pay only 50 rupees. So to that extent, yes, definitely, this credit system is hugely beneficial. And since you asked that question, I'll take it one step further. Yes. Why GST was even more important is that the credit system works across the country now. Under the earlier regime, if VAT was, if say central sales tax was collected on a sale from say Bangalore to Madras, the buyer in Madras had no question of claiming any input tax credit, because that central sales tax was not adjustable against any other amount. So the credit system was put in silos under the earlier regime. So if it is a local sale within Karnataka, yes, that VAT amount is, that credit is available. But now with GST, wherever the supply takes place, from Bangalore to Patna, Bangalore to Delhi, Bangalore to Guwahati, wherever, the credit is freely moving with the supply. So therefore, even a purchaser in Guwahati can claim credit even if the seller is in Bangalore, which was not possible earlier. It was possible to a limited extent under what was called the CENVAT credit rules of 2004. But that was not applicable to sales tax. It was applicable only to service tax and central excise. But again, like I said, it becomes a very, it goes into an entirely different field. So I didn't, I consciously left the entire system of credit out. But since you asked, I just briefly explained it.
Thank you, Mr. Vikram. Again, we have one offline question. Mrs. Lavanya, advocate, when we advocates are paying income tax as an SSE, we are also coming under the purview of professional tax. Speaker's comment, please. And does it not amount to double entry, taxed under income tax as well as professional tax?
As far as that is concerned, I think there are judgments. And if I'm not mistaken, there is even a constitutional provision, which I'm subject to correction. I've seen it. I can't answer it immediately, but I'll look into it. I think there is even a provision which says that there is no question of double taxation, because see, to understand the basics of tax, you have to understand that a tax is leviable on a taxable event. Now, taxable events are distinct from each other. So tax on income is on the accrual of income to a certain person. So that is the event. So when I earn 100 rupees, that is the event that triggers the levy of tax. But a profession tax, the taxable event is on rendering certain professional services, practicing a certain profession. So therefore, the taxable events are entirely distinct. In fact, this question has been raised several times over, right from the 1930s onwards. There are I can't remember the judgments, but there were challenges to the levy of sales tax on the ground that I'm already paying, I say I manufacture a car, I'm paying excise duty on that car. Why should I pay sales tax once again? The federal court, as it was then, clearly explained that these are entirely distinct taxable events. And as long as the same aspect is not taxed, there is no question of double taxation. It will not fall foul of the constitution. So these are distinct.
All right, thank you. Akash, request you to promote Mr. Professor Suresh on to the panel. He has a question. And Mr. Gupta has been raising his hand for quite some time. Yes, you can unmute him. Meanwhile, I also have a offline question. Why there is so much fear and at same time confusion created amongst MSME and traders post-GST? Please enlighten about how the informal sector has been brought under GST ambit.
I don't think the fear is required. In fact, the threshold limit for registration under GST is quite significantly high. I don't know the exact amount, but I think it's substantially higher than what it was under the old service tax and VAT regime. So a lot of the dealers who come below a particular threshold turnover, they don't even require to be registered under the GST law. So I think the fears are slightly misplaced over there. Where the fears, I said, are genuine, and as I was mentioning earlier, I think are actually genuine, are where there are several compliances which are very internet reliant, very technology reliant. I think to that extent, maybe the GST law could have been simplified. The whole concept, there is no concept of manual returns anymore. Everything is online. And when you see the internet penetration across the country, it's not an ideal situation. Of course, the government has come out with other measures, such as they have something called GST practitioners who will help you upload the returns online and so on. But there is still a person required to do that. So maybe for that reason, the MSMEs are a little concerned. The other concern is, yes, there are varying tax slabs. Oddly enough, one of the intentions behind GST was to simplify the tax rates. That quite oddly has not actually happened. Maybe, like I said, these are teething problems. Maybe over the next couple of years, they will, and there are discussions to reduce the number of tax slabs. But right now we have exempt goods, we have 5%, we have 12%, we have 18%, we have 28%, and then 28% plus cess. So we have these many tax slabs. But under the VAT regime, I can tell you for a fact that there were only three tax slabs. There was initially 4%, 12.5%, and exempt. There was nothing else. And there were one or two commodities which were taxable at 20%. But overall, the tax rate system has actually become more complicated. So to that extent, yes, there is a significant scope for litigation there, because earlier, I would know if my goods don't find a place under one of the schedules, I have to pay the residuary rate of 12.5%. But now I have to look at 5% schedule, 12% schedule, 18%, of course, and then 28%. So it's a little more complicated now. I think for all those reasons, there is a fear that GST is more complicated. Also, like as I was saying, the enforcement machinery under GST is quite stringent. There are significantly strong provisions within the GST to enforce. Now they can freeze input tax credit without a notice. They can, which is a live litigation actually going on in our High Court. So the penalty, for example, for a check post matter is a very, very high amount. The value of the goods. So if I'm transporting 70 lakhs or was it 1 crore value of goods, and the rate of tax actually is only about 10% for one. For whatever reason, the prescribed documents do not accompany the movement of goods, I could potentially be levied with a penalty of 1 crore. So, which is, these are quite stringent provisions. So I think overall there is a fear, but largely I would say that the pros outweigh the cons.
All right, thank you. Mr. Gupta, sir, you have been waiting for a while. Please go ahead. Hello, and last sir. Question will be by Professor Sudesh. Yes, sir.
Hello, Vikram. How are you?
Fine, sir.
And wonderful. Sir, GST, it says goods and simple tax, not a service tax. Goods and simple tax.
Good and simple tax.
I'm a guy, that was the statement.
Sir, on account of this GST, the states like Karnataka, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu are losing the benefit, whereas the other states like UP, Bihar, and undeveloped states, they are both more benefited.
I 100% I agree with you, sir. I skipped that portion because of paucity of time. In fact, in my notes, I do have a section dedicated to how the manufacturing centric states like Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Karnataka, or service industries. We have so many service industries in Karnataka. 100% we are losing out. But at least for 5 years, we are supposed to be protected by the central revenues. But at the same time, if you see the, as I was saying, under Article 270, even the central funds that are devolved to the states, as you rightly mentioned, sir, this is completely aside from GST. This is the central fund itself. As I was mentioning, Karnataka gets about 3.6%. Just as a matter of, I'm not commenting on this, just as a matter of fact, I'm stating that Uttar Pradesh gets about 18%. So almost one out of every 5 rupees, almost, collected by the center, which is supposed to be devolved to the states, goes to Uttar Pradesh. And as you rightly mentioned, as far as the GST regime is concerned, it's the place of supply where 50% goes to them. So yes, it is a, so the consumer heavy states will certainly benefit more than the manufacturing states and the service heavy states.
All right, we will have the last question by Professor Sudesh and we'll be winding up the session.
Thank you Vikram, Trivikram. My question is, as a teacher, law teacher, not as a practitioner of taxation, yours was a very wonderful presentation. I wish you were a tax law teacher in our college. My question is, you have spoken about consumer interest at the beginning of your presentation. Between this GST, CST, or the earlier VAT, or etc., ultimately everything is paid by the consumer. So my question to you is a jurisprudential question is, how consumer is no more the king? How do you balance the consumer interest between this GST, CST, and the federalism? Thank you.
As far as you're very right in observing that, yes, the consumer is supposed to be the king. The GST law was in fact brought into force in order to aid the consumer. But like every other legislation, so it has to follow the democratically followed principles of electing representatives who would decide your rates of tax. Just like any other law, you elect your representatives, your elected representatives are supposed to speak for you in parliament or in the state legislatures. Of course, here we have a very powerful GST council as well, consisting, as I was mentioning, of the union finance minister and the state finance ministers. So that way, yes, the consumers' voices are in principle supposed to be heard. But that's it. So otherwise, the act itself does not contain a mechanism where the consumer can voice grievances, where his voice can be heard and action can be taken based on that. A little while earlier I mentioned, and I'd like to thank Mr. Dakshinmurthy for sending me a message. He has just said that the limit to obtain registration is 40 lakhs for goods. So if you're a supplier of goods, it's 40 lakhs and 20 lakhs for services. So it's a significantly high amount. 40 lakhs is a fairly high amount for an annual turnover. So it's much higher than before. So thank you, Mr. Dakshinmurthy, for clarifying that.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Vikram, on behalf of Advocates Association Bengaluru, my sincere thanks to you for today's very informative presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Trivikram. Thank you for having me.
Yes, we'll be logging off the session.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.